much appreciation to all the loyal viewers. And let's see if we can keep it going here. I'm getting ready to embark upon a trip, a journey, a vacation, or something. Not sure what it's going to be. I really don't know. I really haven't made any plans. I'm just going to go somewhere and see what happens. Today's 15th, so that'd be 16th. Now, will I be posting? I don't know. They charge you for wireless internet access, and I'll have to ask them how much. Will I be taping? I believe so. Absolutely. I have a lot of space on memory cards, tape to tape a lot, and then I can, you know, deal with that, see how that works out. So we'll see. We'll see. I'd like to be able to keep on taping, absolutely. So stay calm, stay mellow, be mellow, don't be rushed. Just be mellow. That's one word, just be mellow. Just feel that. See, I am now practicing being mellow. We used to do that. In fact, everybody would, if you got too amped up, people would say, "Whoa, be mellow, brother. Be mellow. Yeah, let's be mellow. Let's just be mellow." And so people would just, they'd remind you. You just, it was a vibe, and you just bump into it all the time. Gosh, I don't know. I you know, those days didn't seem so great when I was going through them, but looking back, in contrast to now, wow, very valuable. Boy, I miss those days, I tell you, where you just, you know you're gonna bump into somebody that's mellow every day. You know you're going to do it. Now, when's the last time I bumped into someone that was mellow? I have no idea. I cannot even, I don't know, have no idea. 10, 20 years or something. I mean, it just doesn't happen. It just doesn't happen. Being mellow actually is a spiritual vibe. Somehow they've caught the transmission from the guru. Somehow they've caught it. They're feeling it. They're saying, "Hey, don't be uptight. You know, there's only one problem. Don't sweat it. Don't sweat it. There's only one problem. We can accept the remedy for that. There's like one pill, and we can take that pill, as it were. That's it. There's only one problem, a continuity problem. And when you realize that, you breathe. Wow. It's not as tough as I thought." So this trip is taking over 2 weeks of intense preparation, getting ready. And we're fairly ready. Still a few things to do. But all in all, so far so good. But wow, what an effort actually. Now, when you're mellow, your brain is not racing for answers. When you know there's just one problem, your brain doesn't have to, you know, you don't have to be jumping all over the place. Your mind doesn't have to be searching frantically here and there. Okay, there's a problem. Oh, there's a problem. There's another problem. No, it centers. It centers. It says, there's only one problem. Just like the dreamer, there's only one problem for the dreamer. And that's that the dreamer is dreaming. It's not the content of the dream that's the problem. Absolutely not the content of the dream. Likewise, it's not the content of existence that's the problem. It's that it's so dissimilar to reality that we fear that we're going to be disoriented if we drop it. and severely, maybe eternally disoriented. That's the problem. It's so the content of a dream is never really the problem at all. So we can say, no, I only have one problem, and that is the continuity problem. That's it. And that's the same as everybody. Is the content of one dreamer's dream is just as irrelevant as the content of some other dreamer's dream. It's all irrelevant. Doesn't matter. That's not the problem. It's never the problem for anyone. So people simply are not seeing what their problem is and avoiding it, thinking that that's solving it. You know, the idea of avoidance equals resolution is the mantra of the world, actually. But when we realize there's only one problem, immediately there's a feeling of sort of deep nervous relaxation where the edge comes off of your nerves, so to speak. The edge comes off of your nerves, and then when the edge comes off of your nerves, you're mellow. Quite warm air today and tonight. Gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous days. My gosh. So, we have to practice taking the edge off our nerves. It builds up again. The edge is like a knife, and it wants to you know, slice and dice. There's a problem. Let me cut it up. Let me cut it up. Let me slice this like this. The mind is like this. You know, want to cut. That's the mind. But when you say, wait, there's only one problem. Okay, then just all. It's only one problem. It's only just one problem. So it's right here in front of me. It's right here. You know, you hear that. Richard Alpert Ram Dass, be here now. Here's a take on it, which I think is something that is very helpful. The problem is here now. See, my problem is here now. I think that's even better. Carbonation. My problem is here now. My problem is right here now. My problem is right here now. Ah, good. I don't have to go chasing after it. I don't have to go looking for it. My problem is here right now. Is right here right now. How wonderful. This is something the ego avoids. The ego's always looking for the problem. Where's the problem? Where's the problem? I can't see it. I can't find it. It's frantically searching. It's like, no, it's right here, right now. I don't have to go anywhere to find my problem. Because it's the continuity problem, which is everywhere. It's always with me. It's always with me. My problem is always with me. You can say that too. My problem is always with me. Again, counterintuitive. The best teaching is counterintuitive, actually. We've gotten so slick at spirituality. It doesn't work for us anymore. It doesn't really work for us. And we know it. We know it doesn't work for us. So that's why we're a little bit ambivalent about it, really. You have to go counterintuitive. That's what actually works, counterintuitive. So my problem, I'm so happy my problem is with me, always with me right now. Wherever I go, my problem is with me. And that's great. That's great. So I can look at it. At all times, it's right here. I don't have to be fine. I can relax. Even when I relax, it's with me. Well, that's great. Even when I go into deep meditation, my problem is with me. Even when I go into sleep, my problem is with me. When I wake up, it's with me. It's always with me. And paradoxically, counterintuitively, that's actually a tremendous relief. I thought I couldn't find my problem, but I have. I found my problem. You know, the key to enlightenment is to find your problem. Find your problem. Find out that it's right here now, right with you, right now. And then you can just, the next step is simply, it's easy then to take the next step. Because if you have it, it's right here now. It's easy to turn it over, right? It's easy to let go of it. The ego says it'll solve the problem as soon as it finds it. But it's not sure where it is or what it is. But we're sure where it is and what it is. It's the continuity problem, and it's right here, right now. So, where is it resolved? Right here, right now. And we know what is being resolved, the continuity issue is being resolved. So our problems are all but solved once we find where they are and what they are. And then we can accept the Holy Spirit's, you know, resolution of the continuity problem. That will come easy once we accept that we do have the problem right now. It's here with us right now. It's in the room. It's in the building. So... I know, and people, the ego tells us we don't have a problem. And we think that spirituality is all about realizing that we don't have a problem. And people are distraught that they can't reach enlightenment and they just can't get to say, I don't have a problem. No. That's not the right way. The fact is we do have a problem. And it's by recognizing that I really do have a problem. I really do have a continuity problem. There's no question about it. And it's a severe problem. That's actually way more liberating because you're being honest and you're no longer like in denial of it and desperately struggling in this denial to say, no, I don't have any problems. What's wrong with me? How come I keep thinking I have a problem? There's something wrong with me. No, there's nothing wrong with you. You have a problem. Absolutely. We have a big, gigantic problem. And it's always with us. So, of course, we feel nervous and scared. It's the continuity problem. It's a whopper of a problem. It's the granddaddy of all problems. It's the one and only problem there is. And it's gigantic. And it's with us right now. And it is bothering us right now. So validate your fears. So yeah, there really is something I'm afraid of. I'm afraid of eternal disorientation, absolutely. And you're not crazy for being afraid of that. That's entirely normal. Because we have been engaged in this training program for so long of trying to teach ourselves how to die that we don't have a clue what reality's like. I don't have, this is no commonality at all to this training program and reality. So of course we're concerned about this issue. Extremely concerned. So by acknowledging your extreme concern, you know, you're putting yourself in the driver's seat. Because when you're denying, other people can control you, right? Because you're afraid, like, oh my gosh, if I don't please them, they might think that I have a problem or something. But when you except, of course, I have a problem. We all have the same problem. Everybody has a problem. It's very liberating, very freeing. You're no longer fighting against yourself. And when then you can accept yourself the way that you are, when you have this gigantic problem, then the Holy Spirit, you can say, hey, Holy Spirit, I have this gigantic problem. I understand that you have the answer to it. You're able to stretch time, as it were, in such a way, in a perception that doesn't see any loss of identity at all taking place, and that solves the continuity problem. So, okay, you know. So it's very different than how we've been trained. How we've been trained is very clever by the ego. The ego's very clever. But when you admit the problem, you accept it, and own it, takes the wind out of the ego sails. It's the truth is easy, but when you go into a world where nobody sees it, they're all denying it, it's incredibly difficult to state the truth, because everybody will say you must be the one that's crazy, not us. We're not seeing anything that you're seeing at all. If it was there, don't you think that everybody would be seeing it? You know, and so there's just too much mental pressure to submit to that consensus. So that makes it incredibly difficult here to speak the truth, even though it's plainly visible. When you have everybody closing their eyes to it, you think, well, you must be the one that is hallucinating and not them. You know, that what they're seeing that is not there must be true, and what you're seeing that it is there must be wrong. And there's that consensus pressure, peer pressure, consensus pressure, you know, just, it's horrible in this world. Really unbelievably terrible. You cannot overstate how tough it is here. And the things that really help are so counterintuitive. You know, people just say, well, I've never heard that. What are you talking about? I thought all the spiritual teaching was like this, you know, and so you can come into the world knowing the truth, and you're going to have just an incredibly difficult time, unless you're really just like a perfect guru. You know, only they can seem to come into this world and handle the pressure. Everyone else is just, they have such trouble. Because everybody just acts so arrogant, like, well, you don't see anything like that. It can't possibly be true. You must be crazy. Like that, and they just, you know, they keep bluffing. They keep bluffing. So it's frustrating. We know the truth within, but we can't speak it. That's the problem, isn't it? We do know the truth within, but trying to externalize it and speak it, oh boy, you know, you just like something like steps up and says, no, that's, you know, people think you're great, you're crazy if you do that, and it stops you. Instead of trying to say you don't have any problems, get rid of problems, etc., just the opposite. Just 1 minute here, please. All right, back. I just was told that they're maybe doing construction on the route that I'm traveling on it, and could be slow going. So anyway, be mellow and not worry about it. Lost the train of thought there. That's okay. Just only one problem. When you lose a train of thought, you just only one problem. And just abide in that. Now, it's difficult to speak up in the world, right? Very difficult. But we're doing it. Counterintuitive. Own the problem. Say, yes, I do have a problem. That's what we're talking about. Everybody has a problem. And then you forgive people. You know, you say, wow, they just have a severe problem. throw it all out and just say everybody has one big problem. They have one big problem, severe problem. So of course they're a little squirrely. Everybody's a little squirrely. Everybody's a little nuts because they have this incredibly huge problem, like an inner monster. So you stop trying to figure out what's going on and why are they like that, why are they like that. Now, everybody's the way they are as a defense against this one problem. And it doesn't matter how you defend against it, but that's not the point. The point is that the Holy Spirit has the solution to it. And that without the Holy Spirit, there'd be no solution to it. So it wouldn't matter then. If there was no answer to it, why do you need to psychologize anybody? It's futile. It's a waste of time. Why do you need to figure anyone's personality out? It's a waste of time. If there's no answer to the continuity problem, it doesn't matter. They're always going to be messed up. But if there is an answer to the continuity problem, then also it doesn't matter. Because whatever defenses they have will be turned over to the Holy Spirit. They'll get a new perception, stable perception. Stable perception, effortless, lovely loveliness. Now, what is lovely loveliness today? I had an insight into that. And that is, you see everything bright, clear, shining, intense, vivid. They're so clear, perfectly clear, you see it all. And yet, it is still mellow. It's very mellow. That's like lovely loveliness. Somehow, the extreme clarity is also extremely mellow. And that's an amazing juxtaposition, actually. It's not fuzzy, there's no fuzziness, everything is crystal clear, and yet it's mellow, very mellow. It has a soft, diffuse mellowness to it, and yet it's totally focused, totally crystal clear at the same time. And that's something that our mind just cannot, the ego just can't deal with that. It tries to fake everything, but it just... Also, you cannot be loyal to the ego and to God, both. It's impossible. The flesh and God, you can't please both of them. You cannot. You're going to displease one of them. You're going to go against one of them, as it were. You're going to go away from one of them and towards the other. Can't please them both, cannot. So hopefully we've thought of most everything. You never think of everything, hardly ever. As we get ready to head out. Now maybe the trip will take longer, I don't know. If the road is blocked and the road is slow, there's no way around it. All a day to life. I miss those times, the mellower times. I'm telling you, what was it like back 50 years ago? Well, tons of problems, of course. But there was a mellower feeling. people who are just naturally not so frantic, not so rushed, not so harassed, not so self-censoring, not so uptight, not so, you know, they're just... What are you doing? Nothing. You know, hey, what's up? What are you doing? No, nothing, nothing. Just hanging out, being mellow, and just... What are your plans? No plans. So, those days are long gone. So it now has to be almost like a specialist type of thing. Being mellow is like a specialty. It's not going to be a worldwide phenomenon, but it can be a specialty. You can specialize in it. And so we should do that. We should do that. We really should specialize in it. Mellow specialist. I'm a mellow specialist. MS. Your name, MS, mellow specialist. I'm a mellow specialist. I'm a specialist in being mellow. You really almost have to present it that way. Those people in Egypt could. I use such a specialist right now. Why can't everybody just suddenly have an epiphany and just say, wow, I'd rather be mellow than all this stuff. And just, you know, people just go up and hug one another and just to say, hey, I just, let's just be mellow together. Let's just, we don't have to save the world. We don't have to build a great country. We don't have to be frantic and all this stuff. Let's start with being mellow. Let's just sit down and listen to the crickets together. That's all. Let's not make plans. Let's not make peace treaties. Let's not make compromises. Let's not do any of that stuff. Let's just sit down and listen to the crickets together. Forget about all those legalistic peace treaties and what this and this and that. We know that that never works. That never works. You can't please everyone. And so we have a laugh about it. Say, how stupid is that to think that we can succeed in that way? That's stupid, of course. So all the different, you know, factions, everybody, all of all religious backgrounds, etc., just sit down and just listen to the crickets together. Maybe have a little mineral water together. Not trying to do anything, not trying to solve anything. And just say, hey, you know, we all have the same problem, the continuity problem. We all have exactly the same problem. What are we fighting for? That's ridiculous. We all have exactly the same problem. And so let's just sit down together and listen to the crickets here. We're not trying to push our problem off on you. We're owning it. Let's own it. Let's all of us sit down here and own our problem. Same problem. We're all in the same boat. Exact same boat. And the problem is right here, right now. We don't have to fight over anything. And and we can have a good laugh about how ridiculous our antics used to be. And then go about your business, and each day you sit down and just listen to the crickets. Say, I have a problem. We all have the same problem. There's only one problem. And God has given us the solution to it. Stretching of time. A new perception. Where there's no loss of identity whatsoever. Therefore, how could anyone fight anyone? There's no fear at all. Nobody's losing anything. So how could there be fear? How could there be attack? How could there be anger, etc.? It's not possible. It's very important when you want to bring about a real accord is to everybody just sit down and don't say anything. Just be quiet. Everybody quiet. Equality right there. Nobody preaching. Nobody trying to make a point. Shouting at each other. No, none of that. Just everybody is just going to sit down and together they're going to listen to the sounds of the desert, as it were. Sounds of the Sahara. Gaze at the stars together, just be quiet. Not try to solve any problems at all. Why? Because we don't have problems. We have one problem, that's it. Can't solve that problem. So let's just sit and be quiet. And maybe we can accept the fact that God solves the problem for us. Somebody got like a race car or something, a Porsche or something. I don't know. I keep hearing that. I don't know what kind of car it is, but. People then won't want to fight. The fight, what are we fighting for? Let's just let things settle down. And let's continue to sit together in silence. Let's just be mellow. Let's just decide, you know what? Let's be mellow. Enough of all this shouting. The shouting back and forth is just a prelude to bombs back and forth and bullets back and forth, really. You see, if we can admit, everybody can admit, if their problem is truly gigantic, incredible, the most difficult situation imaginable, continuity problem, is just an incredible problem. You know, hey, we can all admit to that and say, wow, no wonder why we haven't been able to solve it. It's just ginormous. And we, of ourselves, we can't solve it. And everybody can feel like not so, unequal. They don't feel so small and little and incompetent, etc. If they realize, hey, everybody else here too has the same gigantic problem. No wonder why we're fighting one another. We're so upset by this gigantic problem, and we think that we're not supposed to have it, and we're wrong in having it, and we throw that, so we say, well, somebody else that has it, and I don't have it, etc. But when we can just say, yeah, I do have it, I do have this gigantic problem. We all do. So let's not struggle against it. Let's just sit here quietly together and accept that we do have this gigantic problem. That's okay. It's okay. It's okay to have this problem. Everybody has it. It's okay that we can't solve it. Nobody can solve it. And then we hear, well, the Holy Spirit is custom designed by God to solve it. Fortunate for us. So we're all so fortunate. We're all very fortunate. All of us. So there's another reason why we can sit in silence and just... everyone's accept this mellow feeling, like, you know, we're really all extremely fortunate, all of us, because the Holy Spirit has a solution to the continuity problem for all of us without fail. So we are really all extremely fortunate. What are we fighting for? Do fortunate ones fight one another? No, of course not. We're all equally fortunate. Infinitely fortunate, equally fortunate, so let's just it's not such a tough thing to be a guru, really, so there should be some in the world. It's only tough to get there, but as far as the perspective goes, it's simple. It's very simple. So I would say a real top-notch guru, that this, they just would, this is where we're honing in on what it's all about. It's really just about this. And people will simply come and sit down and be quiet with one another. Everyone together, just quiet together. Not trying to be intensely, some intensity, like I need to reach the silence or something. No. Just relaxing with one another and say, whew, wow. We can drop all this pretense. It's not necessary. The facts are simply the facts, easy. We all have just one problem. There is only one problem. We all have it. We're all infected with it. And yet we're all supremely fortunate because the Holy Spirit has the antidote for every single one of us. And just sit there quietly together. That's all. Enjoy the crickets. And then, of course, you notice the gurus and bliss, and you say, huh, bliss, that's very mellow, that's great. Yeah. That must be the resolution of the continuity problem. Great, okay. So there's really a disconnect, isn't there, between what's going on in the world and what the fact that it's so simple to just people just to sit down and be mellow and quiet together, that's all. It's a complete disconnect. Because you either do one or the other. It doesn't have to be, any teaching at all, really, for the most part. It's just a guru in bliss. There doesn't have to be any real, teaching, actually. You can get it enough of it just sitting quietly. It needs to be mentioned, maybe, that, yeah, we all have just one problem, that's it. But what is wrong with the minds that can't do that? Won't do it. That's a big disconnect. Because the remedy's so simple. What's wrong with the statesmen and stateswomen that can't do that? What's wrong with the leaders, heads of state, who can't do that? What's wrong with them? Well, they have the one problem we all have. And yet they are under the impression that somehow they have the capacity to solve that problem. And so they're talking with saying that they have the answer, and we can find this answer, let us just craft an answer. And they're not gurus, is the problem. They think they have the answer, that somehow God ordained them to provide the answer to the continuity problem, when in fact, they cannot. It's the Holy Spirit that provides it. So, in trying to bring peace and hammer out agreements, it just seems to make things worse. It's amazing. Stop trying to, hammer out agreements. Let's all just agree that we're all in the same boat. With one gigantic problem that we can't solve. That's it. Why don't the heads of state say, you know what, everybody? I can make a presidential address to the world. Just say, you know, everybody, I have a tremendous problem. I share this tremendous problem with all of you. We all have exactly the same problem, and I can't solve it at all. There's no way in the world I can solve it. I'm incapable of solving it, and so are you. We're all equally incapable of solving this problem. But the good news is, God created the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit perfectly solves the problem by stretching time, as it were, putting a different time framework upon perception, so it appears as if no loss of identity is taking place, no symbolic loss of identity is taking place at all. None. But this remedy doesn't come from me, doesn't come from you, it'll never come from any of us, it comes only from the Holy Spirit. So, we don't need to pretend, any of us, that we have the answer. That we're the authors of our own salvation, nobody has to pretend that. And so, I suggest that we start to sit with one another, just sit and just be quiet. Just be quiet. No speeches. How about if all the statesmen stopped giving speeches and just said, you know what? That doesn't work. Instead, let's use this time to be quiet. How about the president of any country going on the national television and saying, coming there and sitting down, and there's the cabinet there, cabinet members, and they all just say, they're out on, maybe instead of in the office, you know, they're out on the lawn or something, or in a garden, and they say, you know, we're just all going to be silent for the next, you know, half an hour or so. And would you like, please, we invite everyone to just join in the silence. No talking, no agreeing, no disagreeing, no goal, no objective. We're just going to be mellow together here. And use the, instead of giving a speech, use the half an hour for that. It would change the world. I mean, it would change our perspective. It would truly work wonders. State saying, look, I got the problem just as bad as you do. I'm just as incapable of solving it as you are. I'm no better or worse than you are at all. In no way am I better or worse than you. But the Holy Spirit will solve it for me perfectly, and will solve it for you perfectly. So, there you go. Let's just have on the networks the hour of silence. Hour of silence. Worldwide hour of silence. Or let's have a day of silence around the world. Everyone in the whole world spends that day in silence. The whole world is silent for one day. We turn off our radios, we turn off our televisions. Everybody sits together. Or by themselves or together in silence. As much as is practically possible. So an international day of silence. Maybe we should have it, you know, today or next, tomorrow. Because the world's in such a terrible situation right now. If we don't have this day of silence, we're going to have the silence of the dead soon. Day where we stop trying to solve our problems. Just stop trying to solve our problems, and let's just sit together quietly. That's all. And maybe we'll recognize, you know what? I can't solve my problems. It's not possible. The world cannot solve its problems, but the Holy Spirit can solve it through an illusion of perception, of course. But that's what the only practical use perception has, is to have this perception that cures all perception, that is stable, and it does not give a sense of loss to it, and then that's similar to reality, so we can then let go of perception altogether. This is the only way. There's only one way. That is to solve, have the continuity problem solved and set perception down. That's the only way back home. You can't bring perception into reality. It's not possible. So there's only one way. And in order to set perception down, we have to have the continuity problem resolved for us. Otherwise, we're too scared to do it. So, that is the way. But the first step is for people to recognize that, hey, it's okay to have this problem. It's okay. It's okay. We all have it. And you know, if we don't have the leaders of the world, the leaders of the planet, these people that everybody looks up to, if they don't do that, you know, people are just going to get the idea that that's not it. So that's why you have the gurus. But we could certainly use one. International Day of Silence. Think about it. Yeah, nobody wins, nobody loses. No arguments, no verbal play, no cleverness. Even they have to shut the courtrooms down. Disputations and arguments, and the whole legal system takes a day off. A one-day jubilee around the world. Just everybody silent. Everybody. From all religions, all generations, etc. Everybody just says, you know what? Let's take a time out for one day. Let's just take a global time out. Maybe a guru will show up that will do that. That's possible. That is possible. And people will pick up on it, and it will happen. That's about the only thing that can save the world at this point. Really, the only thing that I can see that would be helpful is a global timeout. A global timeout. Just a global timeout. And people from every village and city and the whole world start doing this and inviting everybody and saying, invite the meeting. We're going to take a day where everybody takes a day off. And you know what? We're bigger than the legal system, all right? We don't need to be bullied by a legal system. We can do this. Of course, everyone will say, well, but we have obligations to our sponsors. You know, we can't just say nothing. We have to put these programs on and we'll be sued and all this kind of stuff. Well, just do it anyway. Maybe Oprah could start it, because she's been talking a lot lately. Maybe she can just have a program. No guests, no topic, no talking at all. And in fact, she doesn't even have to be on the stage. She can sit up in the audience, or people can just sit all over the set, wherever. Everybody just sits there. Sits there together, quietly, saying nothing. No topic. Not trying to bring world peace or anything, not trying to do anything, just sit quietly and don't say anything. Just listen together, listen. Maybe they sit by a river or something. Just listen. Listen to the natural sounds, just listen. Don't be trying to figure anything out. Don't be trying to bring peace to the world. Just set your arrogance down. Give it a break. Give it a timeout. Give your arrogance a timeout. So maybe somebody can do this. Again, everybody will say, yeah, it's a great idea, but you know, I'll be fired if I do that. I'll lose my job on everything, you know. We have to keep, we have obligations financially, we have sponsors, everybody's money flowing, we have to. Well, if you don't take a time out, you're going to lose all that anyway. So why not take a risk and say, you know what, It's worth a gamble right now. It's worth an audacious play right now. I need to make an audacious play right at this point. We should realize that we're in a time of audacity as far as making a play goes. It needs to be audacious. It needs to be something that just shifts gears for us. We have to shift gears. The guru is the gear shifter, really. The guru is the gear shifter. And with that, I better get to sleep. Wrap it up. All right. Wish me well on this trip, and we'll see. Maybe we'll find a guru. Maybe we'll start the day of silence. Okay. Very great. Thank you, everybody, for watching. I appreciate it. That's it.